Hi, my name is Meredith, and I'm a student studying psychology from Canada. My question is very simple. How can you say that men and women, that there's no sexism when the very setup of this conference is sexist? For example, the men are seated in front of the women.
Can you repeat the question a bit slowly, sister?
Yes. Why is it that the men are seated in front of the women? The very structure of this conference is sexist. Why is that?
MashaAllah, sister, that's a very good question. That why aren't the women seated in front?
No, why are we not, if you're going to separate us, how come we're not left to the right?
Correct.
Why is one in front
sister
of the other?
Sister, a very good question. That why are the women, if you believe in equal, why not left and right? Why not? It's a very good question, sister. Because the Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 30, say to the believing man that he should lower his gaze and guard his modesty. Whenever a man looks at a woman, any brazen thought comes in his mind, he should lower his gaze. Now, if the women are sitting on my right, I will only have to speak looking on the left. You know, because I cannot look at them. Yeah, I can look at everyone. This time I cannot see your face also from here. You may look at my direction. If you want to see me close, you can see on the screen there, no problem. But for me, the Quran says, the moment I look at a woman, I should lower my gaze. Unless she's my wife, or she's my mother, she's my daughter. And if someone says that someone looks at a woman and nothing happens to him, then he requires a psychiatrist. So if you were here, I would talk to you like that. So you'll tell me, what an ill-mannered man is this? You know, showing me his back. Now my gaze is there. Knowing the microphone, I cannot see you. I can just see, okay, just a little bit here and there. So I'm maintaining my hijab. Now when we have lady speakers speaking, only ladies, front row, no problem. So what happens, because it's a gent speaking, there are occasions, some occasions, then we have to keep a partition, and we can do that, and we have done that. But there's such a vast gathering, so many cameras, it will obstruct. So that is the reason, but in no way are we trying to say that the women are inferior. That is the reason you have got a screen close to you, mashallah, especially for sisters who are sitting a bit more behind, so you can get the view. But in front, it will be difficult for me to speak, for me to maintain my hijab, for me to look. Because in public speaking, you know, we are taught we have to look at the audience. If the audience is a woman in front of me, you know, I remember once I'd gone to the Gulf country. And I was called for a talk. And a ladies' organization. I always say that at least the front row should be gent, you know. But they didn't do it. So half the talk I gave looking at the ground and balance half looking at the ceiling. Down ceiling up. Believe me, I was in hell. Not because I was in company of ladies. I was in hell because half my lecture I gave looking at the ground and half my lecture looking at the ceiling. I had to maintain my hijab. Here I can talk to the person, I can look at him, I can stare at him. If he's sleeping, I stare at him, he stops sleeping, you know. The public speaking. But with the ladies, therefore, it is for maintaining the hijab. So that is the reason, sister, it is not at all in any way trying to belittle them. And the reason we have given you one microphone instead of two, because we feel that the proportion is approximately 1/3, 2/3. That's the reason. But the moment last time when there were more ladies, we gave equal proportion. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Thank you.
Good evening, doctor. I have been coming regularly to your Peace TV conferences for the last so many years. My question is, I am in a situation of two families, both are Muslim families. I know the boy, I know the girl, the families. I have been the media coordinator of those boy and girl, and they are going to get married. So can a non-Muslim be a witness of the agreeing family and the boy and girl to the nikah?
Brother asked a very good question, that he has two friends, both are Muslims, one from the girl's side, one from the boy's side. He's the mediator, he knows both of them, and he got them together. Can he be a witness to the marriage of?
As they are telling me to be the witness.
As they're telling me to be the witness. Can you be? You can be, under one condition only. Condition is applied. If you bear witness that there's no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad is a messenger, you can even be a witness to the nikah.
Thank you.
Hope that answers the question.
Thank you.
Brother, this question is from a non-Muslim sister. She is present in the audience, but for security reasons, she will not like to come on the microphone. I'll be reading a question. If a non-Muslim girl wants to marry a Muslim boy and the Muslim boy asks the girl to convert, not by force, but because he wishes her to accept the religion, is it wrong? Meaning, is it wrong on the part of the boy to ask to convert? Secondly, if a non-Muslim girl marries a Muslim boy without converting but still follows the Islamic religion as it is supposed to be followed, is it wrong on the part of the girl to follow the religion but without converting? Her name is Khushbu. She's a teacher by profession.
Just to ask the question, there's a non-Muslim, I have to ask a question, that can a non-Muslim girl, if she wants to marry a Muslim boy and the Muslim boy requests her to accept Islam, is it right? And if a non-Muslim girl follows Islam without converting, is it acceptable? The Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 221, that do not marry unbelieving women until they believe. Do not marry a mushrika until they believe. Because it further says that it is preferable to marry a believing woman even if she is a bondswoman, even if she may be a servant, even if she may be ugly. It is far superior to marry a believing woman who's a bondwoman rather than an unbelieving woman, even if she attracts you. She may be the most beautiful woman, she may be a beauty queen, she may be the wealthiest woman, but a believing woman is far superior. So in terms of, is it right for a Muslim man to ask the non-Muslim woman to convert before marrying? It is not right, it is a must. Without she accepting Islam, he cannot marry her. Why? I'll tell you. For example, if I tell you that there is a car, one tire is of a cycle and the other is of a tractor, will the car run? No. All the tires should either be of a bicycle, you'll have a handcart at least, or of a tractor, you'll have a proper tractor. Because when you're leading a life, the views and philosophies, the major thing, the goal of Jannah should be same. Coming to your second question, that if a woman follows the teachings of Islam but does not convert, is it acceptable? See, for conversion, you don't have to publicly announce. You don't have to come on the microphone and say, I bear witness that there's no God but Allah. It's not a must. If you feel your life is in danger, if you say within your heart and tell it to Almighty God, you don't even require any witness. It's between you and Allah. So there is no particular ceremony that is required. But proclaiming is preferable so that the people in the world don't misunderstand you. But if you feel your life is in danger, if you proclaim to Allah only and keep it in your heart and follow, alhamdulillah. Following is more important than proclaiming. It is preferable for the lady not to mention but yet follow Islam than to mention she has converted and not follow Islam. Have you heard my answer? It is preferable for a non-Muslim woman to practice Islam without proclaiming rather than proclaim and not practice Islam. Practicing is more important than proclaiming. It's between her and Allah. So the moment she starts practicing Islam, it's understood. When she offers salah, she agrees there is one Allah and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger. The moment you say akama, it is in that akama you believe that there is no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger. Finish. So if she starts practicing, she doesn't have to proclaim also. So if she wants to do the second, practicing is more important than proclaiming. But if she wants to proclaim, it is fine, she can proclaim. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, brother.
Yeah. Hare Krishna. Here I am looking, I came here first time. People are very eager to know about his life, woman and man. But this discussion, you think this discussion will really solve our real problem of life, birth, age, old and disease and death that we are suffering from birth, old age, death and disease? That will this problem will solve in our life to married with some nice woman or wealthy woman or brother good relationship with a woman.
Brother, the question, we have come here to discuss about men and women's rights, marriage. Will it solve a problem of diseases? Some problem it will solve. If you marry a woman, you have less chance of having
STD. But the real problem of life is...
Brother, you ask the question, let me give the reply. You ask the question, we are discussing here about men and women and life and marrying. Will it solve the problem of diseases, etc.? Brother, are you listening to me? You're looking there and listening here. Very good. So it will solve some of your problem of disease. If you marry a woman you like, inshallah, you won't go to outside. So less chance of having STD. sexually transmitted diseases, less chance of having AIDS. So if you marry correctly, it will solve some of your problems of disease, not all. Fine. But this session is talking about women's rights. So we have different lectures and different sessions talking about different solutions for humanity. Today is the solution for the women's rights. You come from my last lecture, purpose of life. That will get a real solution to life. So I've kept that in waiting. You know, final round. You know, the best is always last, correct? This is my first talk. Then I'm going to come on Friday again, give a talk on Al-Quran, should have the understanding. Then Saturday, open question answer session. Last day, final, purpose of our life. If you come for that, inshallah, most of your questions of life will be answered. Hope that answers the question.
Okay, Hare Krishna.